obviously, the context was the demolition of the mosque in 1992, which happened just a month before I returned from England to India. The riots that followed, I was caught in the second round of the riots in Bombay on the 10th of January, attending an exhibition in Jahangirat Gallery, and the riots started. It was difficult getting back home. Bhupen Kakkar exhibition, I remember. The whole business of religion entering politics. And I was a little perplexed because forget the Hindu nationalists. The discourse that was emerging from what I call the left liberals or whatever, I found it a little clumsy, to put it mildly. Because the rhetoric of the left liberals was exactly the same as the Hindu nationalists at a methodological level. That is, there is a good nationalism and there is a bad nationalism. I thought that one had to disengage the whole enterprise of looking at what's happening to us. I mean, if that was the basic question, what is happening to us? From the question of nationalism. Nationalism had played its role as an emancipatory idea during the freedom movement as much as it has played a role in every post-colonial society. But it has become a hindrance in many ways, in many countries. It's become debilitating. It's become even toxic in many, many post-colonial countries. In this decent enterprise, there is this assumption, which it's only late 18th, 19th century, that we are a peace-loving people, that we always extolled peace and non-violence as a central concept, and that hinges upon this stray phrase, ahimsa paramo dharma. First of all, while the phrase appears several places in the Mahabharata, in absolutely different contexts. So the context is important. The operative idea that is in the Mahabharata is not ahimsa. It is a concept which we have lost. And it is a concept called anrasamsha. Non-cruelty or non-harm. So anrasamsha is actually compassion, kindness, mercy, empathy. And as a consequence, absence of cruelty. The idea that the Buddha preached radical non-violence is used by the entire ideological spectrum in India. Whether you are left, right, center, everybody says the example of the Buddha as the epitome of non-violence. The truth of the matter is that the Buddha never preached non-violence, radical or otherwise. I think Gandhi's uniqueness among all the thinkers from the 19th century onwards is that he realized he didn't buy into this trope of we are essentially peaceful, etc., except for rhetorical purposes. He also does that. He very consciously recognizes that neither Hinduism nor the Hindus have ever been purely nonviolent. What Gandhi does is to say, okay, if this is the core of the nation, if we agree that religion or spirituality or whatever you call it is the core of the nation, then we have to introduce nonviolence as not merely a concept within Hinduism, but a foundational, central concept within Hinduism. Starkly put, Savarkar dismisses nonviolence as belonging to the ascetic. Gandhi converts the same asceticism into political asceticism. Even in the Hindu Swaraj, when he is talking about the Satyagrahi, there are codes of conduct which are to do with the ascetic. You will not marry. You will not have property. You will adhere to perfect brahmacharya. Look at Gandhi's instructions to the Satyagrahis when the Satyagraha was the program was running. They are all the do's and don'ts of an ascetic. In a certain sense, his is a political ascetic.
Yeah.
What does Bhishma say to Yudhishthira, who is a little proto Gandhi, agonizing about the fact that if as a Kshatriya I am allowed to kill for food, but if I have enough to eat, should I kill or should I not kill? What does Bhishma say to him? Meat eating may be bad, but moral pride is worse. All this non-violent business as a mode of dissent, to a great extent, the talk of it, not the practice, is the talk of the privileged. All of us included. What happens in villages, what happens among the poor, the women, the destitute, I don't think they have the privilege to say, we will die but uphold non-violence. No,